On Sunday, man, Easter time is almost here. What a wonderful and great time for the church and for Christians. Easter. You know, I think Easter is all of the other things of life all rolled up into one big celebration, that time of Easter. Palm Sunday, we're all familiar with the time Jesus is, he's coming into the city. And so let's pick up right there. If you have your Bibles this morning, and I hope that you do, if you would find your way to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. We're going to be looking at verses 28 through 44. And I'm sure when you get there, you'll recognize it. Very familiar story. And we've talked, I'm sure you've heard it read and read it yourself many times. So let's read it this morning. Again, Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 28. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he set two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.' As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, 'If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. But now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you, and you will and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and your children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word this morning. So Jesus is on a road and he's coming into the city. I want to ask you, I remember my dad in later years in his life, he got where he wasn't able to drive, but he still loved to ride. And I can remember my mom and him, especially on a Saturday afternoon or Sunday afternoon, and I don't know if anybody does this anymore, but they would just take a Sunday afternoon drive. And they would drive. Debbie and I sometimes, we would do that. We'd take a Sunday afternoon drive. We would just get in the car with no particular destination in mind, nowhere to actually go, and we would just start out on a drive, and we would enjoy each other's company, and we would just enjoy looking at the beauty of the things around us and things. You know, I think sometimes nowadays we're in such a hurry. We actually don't stop and do things like that anymore. Of course, it could be because of the price of fuel. Maybe that might have a lot to do with taking that Sunday afternoon drive. But, you know, one of the other things we would always do when we would take that Sunday afternoon drive is, I say it like this, we would always stop and get a sweet. Yeah. What I'm saying is we would always stop and get us an ice cream cone. Yeah? That's almost, you know, if you're going to take a Sunday afternoon drive, that's almost as important as taking that Sunday afternoon nap. It's got to be part of it. That's got to be part of the trip. But we would just get in the car and we would just take a drive with no particular destination in mind. So, this morning, let's apply that idea to our lives. Do we live our lives in that same manner, with no destination in mind or even in view? We're just living life. You know, we so often, what's the expression? You know, you ask somebody what's going on, and most of the time, what do we hear? Same stuff, different day. So nothing in particular is going on. Have we allowed life to become kind of casual and mundane? Nothing predictable is happening in our lives. We just merely are existing. We just kind of get up in the mornings and we know what our routine is and we start our routine. It's a routine. We know what time we're going to get up and we know when we're going to be here and we know when we're going to be here. And we really start off and we're really not expecting anything different in that day. Do you find yourself just simply going through the motions of what a Christian should be and what the Christian life should be? If so, maybe we need on this Palm Sunday to get a whole new perspective on life. So walking the road of life with Christ is so much more than a Sunday drive. It's intentional, that walk with Christ. It's intentional to us, and we have to give that attention back to it. It's just not something that happens. It's so much more than just merely coming to church on Sunday morning. You know, it can be the most exciting, the most joyful experience that we can ever have. And you know what? It doesn't have to be just on Sunday morning or Sunday night or Wednesday night or when we get together. But this is an excitement and a joy that we should have every single day. But you know, it all depends on which road we're traveling and the destination that we have in mind. You know, truly coming to Christ is a radical, life-changing event. You can't come to Christ and stay the way you are. It just can't happen. That's just a physically and spiritually, it's just not possible. It's a life-altering event. You know, walking or living with Christ. We use that term quite a bit. Walking with Christ, living with Christ. Walking or living implies a continuous, ongoing process. We're walking. We're moving forward. We're living. We're not just alive, but we're living daily, hourly. So this means that we're going to walk in the same direction that Jesus is walking. We need to continue to walk. You know, so often in our Christian life, or just in life in general, it seems like we sort of move forward and then we'll stop for a little bit and we'll just stand. Or maybe we'll even just get tired and we'll stop and we'll sit down for a little while. We need to continue to walk, not sit or stand in the path that Jesus would walk in. We need to follow the path that Jesus would go, and we need to live the kind of life that Jesus would live. I want to ask you this morning, the path that you're walking, is it the path that Jesus has led you down? Is it a path that you're following Jesus down? Are the paths of life that you're on, are they committed paths? Is it a path of obedience? Is it a path of forgiveness? Or is it the path of sin and pride and self? Is the life that you're living pleasing to the Lord? Well, if it's not, then you're not walking in Him. And you, therefore, are like the sheep at the edge of the pasture. you sort of got away from the flock, and you're over here right at the edge, not with the flock, but you can kind of see them. And you're over here all by yourself. Well, I want to tell you this morning, there's a wolf standing at the edge of the weeds. And he's licking his chops, and he's smiling. And he's got his knife and his fork out, and he's getting ready. He's got his plate prepared. See, that's the way we like to live. We like to be able to keep the flock in sight, but sort of stand over here on the edge of things. You know, we treat sin like that an awful lot as well, you know. We kind of know where that line is. We even make a line. We even draw that line right down here, all right, and we label it, and we call it sin, and we're over here, and in life, we like to run right up to it and stop just before we get to it. And we keep doing that over and over, and then all of a sudden, what happens? We run up to it, and then we can't quite stop. And we fall over that line, and we're on the other side, and there, that wolf is waiting for us to devour us. You see, if your Christian life resembles a Sunday drive, or maybe your Christian life even resembles a roller coaster ride, then you can establish stability in your daily walk with Jesus. And the way that we can do that, we must be on the same highway that he's on. We've got to be on the same road that Jesus is on. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13 and 14 says, "Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that lead to destruction. And many enter through it, but small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." You know, we read that scripture, and automatically we start to think, narrow is the road. Narrow, that's going to be a hard road. That's going to be, how can I walk on a narrow road and enjoy all the things of life? How you know, we the world tells us that road is so narrow. The only way that we can walk on that road is like a tight road, and we have to put one foot in front of the other. And I can't even do it walking on the ground. We have to walk on a tightrope, and we're so focused on being balanced and being able to walk on that little thin line. The world tells us that we can't enjoy life. But I want you to know this morning that is not the road that Jesus Christ has laid out before us. That road that he has laid out before us, it is just wide enough that we can put both feet solid on the ground. And that we can walk, and we don't have to look down to see where we're going, because he's already made that path. He's made that road for us. And we can walk confidently in that road, one step at a time, knowing that he's made a way for us. You know, the National Highway and Safety, Traffic Safety Board Administration was founded, and it was founded and it was charged with the task of reducing deaths, injuries, and economic loss resulting from motor vehicle accidents. There have been all kinds of studies. It's an amazing thing, even though there's been all kinds of studies. Most of the studies conflict with each other, and they contradict each other. But one of the things that does not conflict is they did a study, and it is said that you are about 12 times less likely to be involved in a traffic accident when you are driving on a one-way street. You know, I think that's that is very true, and that's the same truth that when we're walking with Jesus and we're walking on a one-way street, we're less likely to be involved. Yes, being a Christian does not exempt us from trouble. It doesn't exempt us from the potholes and the sharp turns and maybe even another vehicle coming the wrong way down a one-way street. Those things are going to happen. But when we're walking with Jesus on a one-way street, we're less likely to be involved in a mess. You know, we're all on a road, and that road is called the road of life. And there are many stops along this road. There are many rest areas on this road. And some of these places that we stop and are good, and some of them are not so good. At different places along life's journey, they're crossroads that we go through. They're intersections, and they're marked by the cross of Jesus. And these crossroads are places of eternal decisions. At the crossroad, the path is divided, and we have to make a choice. And we can decide whether we're going to stay on this broad road or that leads to destruction, or we're going to exit onto the narrow road that leads to eternal life. See, the direction that we choose at the crossroad not only has serious ramifications for the rest of our journey, but what's so important about this decision, it's going to determine our final destination. So which road are you on? Are you at a crossroad at this very minute of your life? So what are you going to do? Which road will you take? Will you listen closely to the directions, to the right road? Or will you just ignore those directions and take the road that you want to take because the world tells you it's your life and you should just be able to do what you want to do and just live it how you want to be able to live it? I want to tell you a story of a woman who was driving home one night, and the weather was really bad and it was raining in sheets, and she could not see, and down the road she saw a set of taillights on another vehicle, and she said, "Oh, thank goodness." Said, "I can follow that car. I can follow that car, and that'll help me to get where I'm trying to go." And so she eased up close where she could keep those taillights in view, and she felt a lot better because now she wasn't there all by herself. But she had somebody she could follow. And she still couldn't tell where she was going, but she knew she was going, and there was somebody going in the same direction she was going in, and she pulled right up behind him. So all of a sudden, they're driving along, and she noticed that the car stops. And she's thinking, "Oh my, what in the world has happened? Maybe they hit a deer, or maybe there's something, some debris in the road or something." She didn't know, and she started to worry. She was feeling uncomfortable. And she knew that in a storm like this, in the middle of the road, was not a place to be just stopped out in the middle of the road. Then all of a sudden, the car in front of her cut the lights off. Man, she was really starting to get a little bit worried. She was really concerned. She's sitting there, and actually, not only is she concerned, but she's getting a little bit aggravated. Now, why in the world would this car in front of me stop in the middle of the road and then cut its lights off? In a few minutes, she heard a knock on her window, and it was a gentleman. She cracked down the window, rolled down the window a little bit, and he was going to ask her what the problem was, and she snapped back real quick, said, "Well, what's my problem?" She said, "What's your problem? You stopped here in the middle of the road, and now you cut your lights off. And traffic could be coming along." And he said, "Ma'am," he said, "you don't understand." He said, "We're not in the middle of the road. We're in my driveway." Now, the whole point of that is that she had chosen the wrong one to follow. Obviously, that woman had chosen the wrong leader. She had chosen a leader who didn't take her to the place she was trying to go to or she needed to go. She had chosen the wrong leader and the wrong road. Who are you following this morning? Who are you watching this morning? Which road are you on? Jesus told us in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7 and verses 13 and 14 that there are two main roads which we can travel. And one is a wide road that leads to destruction, and the other is a narrow road. But it's a straight road. No curves, no turns. see, he's pointing you to the cross of Jesus Christ, the right direction. We don't want to miss that. Today is Palm Sunday. It marks the day that Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. It marks the beginning of the last week of his life as a man here on this earth, among his disciples, among those who followed him, among mankind. Jesus bids us to follow him on the road to Jerusalem. Following his leadership, walking his road, leading us to life, life everlasting, eternal life. There are basically only two main roads to travel in life. The road that leads away from God and the road that leads to him. So which one are you on? The wide road that leads to destruction? Wide, it's broad, it's spacious, and it's an easy road to travel down. It's lots of room. We don't kind of bump into people and that kind of thing. It's the road of tolerance and permissiveness. There are no curbs or no boundaries on this road. Travelers on this road follow their own inclination. They just kind of go when they want to, and they go where they want to, and they do their own thing. If it's right for you, it must be okay. And there are multitudes going down this road today. They seem to be either unconcerned or careless about the spiritual reality of where this road is going to carry them. You see, it's a road of uncommitment. You cannot be neutral, see, when it comes to the things of Jesus. There isn't any comfortable middle ground. You know, we just can't pull off into the medium. You know, Christianity isn't about being very good or very bad or even very comfortable. It's about following. It's about walking the road of Jerusalem with Jesus. It's about staying on the narrow road, the straight road. It's about not being self-centered. It's about not letting that sin lead us to a final destination that is away from the love and grace of Jesus Christ. Which road are you on today? Jesus wants you to travel his road. The whole life of Christ was the divine plan of salvation for mankind, for me and for you. That was his whole life's purpose, to lead us down a road that was not a final destination of sin and death and hell, but of glory with him. You know, all that Jesus went through was for the fulfillment of that plan of salvation for us. He knew when he was walking into the city or riding into the city that day, he knew all of the things that were coming, but yet he still loved us. He was obedient, and he was obedient to the Father, but that's only part of it. He goes one more step. He was obedient to the Father. But he loved us so much that he went to that cross. Can you just stop and try to imagine? We can. We think in our mind we know that kind of love, but it's hard to get our human hearts and our human minds around that kind of love. He traveled that road in obedience. And he traveled that road because he loved humanity. Are you willing to follow Christ no matter what he asked you to do this morning? The road to Jerusalem was one of submission for Christ Jesus. Jesus always submitted himself to the Father. His first priority was the Father. His purpose was to do the Father's will. We need to lay it down this morning, all before the Father. Complete submission. We need to lay it all before him, but we don't. We get hung up on the crossroads of life, and sometimes we take little detours. You know, I want to close with this. I remember a while back, I was doing something, and I was backing out of the driveway. And I got started off at the wrong angle, coming and backing out of the driveway. That's why we have a circle driveway, by the way, so I can drive around on it and back. But I was backing out of the driveway, and I started off in the wrong direction right from the beginning. And no matter how much I tried to correct that, it just seemed like it got worse and worse. And finally, I just had to stop. I pulled all the way back up, and I started all over. You know, sometimes we have to do that. Sometimes we have to just stop, go back to the beginning, and start all over again. And that's okay with Christ. See, he asks us to do that. He says, hey, it's fine. We got do-overs. We got mulligans. We can do that. Isaiah chapter 35, verse 8 through 10 says, and a highway will be there. It will be called the way of holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lions will be there, nor any ravenous beast. They will not be found there, but only the redeemed will walk there, and those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. That's the road I want to be on. That's the road I want to be walking down. I want to ask you again this morning, what road are you on this morning? You know, Jesus fully knew the road that he was on. He understood the consequences and all that was going to happen. But, you know, he stayed on the road. He calls us to stay on that road, that one-way road with him. He said that he would make it wide enough that we could walk down it and still be able to live life. And it would not be just any life, but it would be an abundant life. So I ask you this morning, what road are you on? Would you go with me to God in prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day that, Lord, that we can come and Lord, that we could celebrate. Just as they celebrated Jesus coming into the city. Father God, we could celebrate Jesus in our lives this morning. Father God, I pray that as we do that, Father, you would help us to if we're not on the right road. Lord God, help us to back up. Or Lord, maybe we're an intersection in our life. Lord, help us to turn on the right road, the road that you're walking on. Father, help us to follow you. Lord, help us to see you as our leader. Lord, and help us to see, Lord God, that the road that you have laid out for us is a road of a life eternal with a loving God and a loving Jesus. And Lord, the road to destruction, it's a wide road. It's an easy road. And Lord, it seems like the world tells us that it's the greatest time in the world. And Lord, the world's going to come to an end one day. But eternity is still going to be staring at us, and it's going to be calling for us. So Lord God, where will we be when eternity calls our name? Father God, I pray that we would be standing and looking you right in the face, and you welcome us into your eternal home. And Father God, we just thank you for your word this morning. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.